Would I dare stand for the truth? One day, when alone in my rented flat in Istanbul, I saw myself as a man who had faced only difficulties. Sadness overcame me like a heavy weight as I recounted all the bad events which had occurred throughout my life. The world and everything in it, including myself, seemed unjust. I turned my face up to heaven and cried out to God, "Why don't you help me? I know that you are mighty and can help me." I was so angry at God. I wanted him to appear so that I could hit him, believing he was the reason for my pain. Why should I carry such burdens when there was a mighty Creator who was able to save and comfort me? From the depth of my heart, I believed that there was a God and that he could help me, but I thought that he was ignoring me. In the midst of these emotional moments, my conscience started to raise its critical view. Which God are you crying to Allah or the God of the Bible? To an impersonal God or the personal God? To a God who does not have an ear to hear or to one who has an ear? It was amazing that my conscience was counseling me to cry to a God who is personal, has ears and listens. It was telling me that Islam was a barrier between me and my Creator and Savior since it does not believe in any personal relationship between God and humanity. I didn't know that my cries in Islam were futile since I was not crying to the true God. How could I cry and express my personal agony and anger to an impersonal God? An impersonal God would not be able to understand my personal needs and relate to me personally. So the pain in my heart and the tears of my eyes taught me meaningful lessons and directed me to the true and living God. The moment was very logical and also ripe for lifting my eyes to heaven sincerely and meaningfully. It was the first time in my life that I was seeing the necessity of an immediate touch and healing from God, believing he could reveal himself to me personally and help me. The following night, I had a dream. There were earthquakes and violent winds. People were running and crying. Houses were demolished and many people were killed. I was in my father's house alone. It was the same house in which I grew up. In my dream, I stayed in the open room at the front of the old house and cried out to God, "Why don't you help me? I'm alone here." Immediately after my cry, a light appeared in the sky and said, "I am Jesus. Come out of your father's old house. Be not afraid. I will help you." So I rushed out of my father's house and ran toward an apple tree in the front yard, which the light showed me. I fell to the ground and turned as the old house fell down. When I awoke, the startling dream kept me from falling back to sleep. The events in the dream began to occupy my mind. I wondered if something was going to happen to me. I was rescued, but my father's house was destroyed. Did the dream mean that I was safe outside my country, but my other family members, including my wife and children, were going to die? I also started to question God's response to my cry. I thought that I had asked for help, but he destroyed my old house. In the Middle East, the expression of the deepest pain of your life is verbalized by the saying, "My house was ruined." Was I going to face more difficulties and experience more pain in the future? In the following days, I was filled with anxiety. I prepared myself for bad news. The next Sunday, I went to church, still hoping for news of my money. What I heard shocked and amazed me. The title of the sermon was, "The House on the Rock of Jesus," from Luke 6:48. The preacher spoke of things that I had seen and heard in my dream. He was calling the congregation to newness of life. Leave your old house. Leave your father's house. Your old house is a house of sin, the house of your selfish desire and the house of your old nature that you've inherited from Adam. It is a house built on sand, which is easily destroyed. Come out. Leave it, otherwise it will collapse on you. Come and live in the house that Christ has built for you on the rock. Nothing can destroy this house, because it is the house of absolute freedom, joy, and peace. Christ is the Prince of Glory, peace, and love. His unconditional love has lifted him up, soaring on high like an eagle. He wants to establish you on this higher ground. This is the ground where Satan cannot reach. It is the ground of God, the ground of salvation and victory over all inhuman and ungodly attitudes and values. Come to him. Do not ignore his call. What was happening here, I thought. I wasn't sure if it was real or if I was having another dream. The words of the sermon completely captivated me, but I said nothing. I still had reservations about being seen with Christians, and I still wanted my money, but inside I felt different. I decided to read the Bible to see if anything in it related to my dream or to the words of the preacher. On the way home, the message, "Come out from your old house and live in the house of Jesus," replayed in my mind over and over. I understood that it referred to spiritual newness. The idea of newness was not strange to me as I had delved into mystic and poetic philosophy. They spoke of newness and unity with God, each without their own type of doctrine and theory. As I repeated the call of the preacher in my mind, I was becoming more interested in reading the gospel to see if it supported a different kind of unity. If yes, I thought, then this has to be a new philosophy that I'm not aware of. From reading the first pages of the gospel, I was amazed. I discovered that unlike all other religions, the salvation of humanity and the establishment of God's kingdom in their hearts is a present reality, not left for the life after. The gospel proclaims the personal presence of God among people. Those who recognize the presence of God and open themselves to Him receive the kingdom of God in their hearts. The kingdom of heaven is near, Matthew 3:2 and 4:17. The kingdom of God is within you, Luke 17:21. Unlike the God of the Bible, Allah in Islam is not a personal God able to have a personal relationship with His people or establish His kingdom in their hearts. He did not reveal Himself even to His own apostle and messenger, Muhammad. If He did not reveal Himself to Muhammad and did not talk to him personally, how then could Muhammad talk about Him without knowing Him personally? You need to know someone in order to be able to talk about Him. So, the gospel was opening my mind to understand that Allah could not be relevant to life if He was impersonal, unable to talk personally, and relate Himself to humanity. As I was meditating on this issue, I gradually started to doubt Allah's existence. Muslims say that Allah asked the angel Gabriel to convey His message, the Quran, to Muhammad rather than talking to him personally. This also appeared to me a wrong philosophy. If Gabriel was able to reveal Himself to Muhammad, He would be a personal, revealing being. How then could impersonal, non-revealing Allah reveal Himself to the personal Gabriel and send Him as His personal ambassador to Muhammad? It is impossible for an impersonal being to have a personal relationship with a personal being. Also, the impersonal God cannot talk because He does not have a mouth. We cannot attribute any head, mouth, ear, eye, hand, or leg to an impersonal God since He's non-revealing, unknowable, and indescribable by human vocabulary. No one can see an impersonal God or hear from Him. So how could Gabriel describe Him? The whole authority of the Quran concerning the existence of Allah came under question in my mind. Also, since Allah did not reveal Himself to Muhammad and did not talk to him personally, where then could the Quran come from? How could it be the instructions of the personal God for the personal needs of humankind? It cannot be anything but Muhammad's own personal words. My mind was trying to bring everything of Islam to the surface and evaluate it under the light of the gospel's philosophy of God, even though I had not given my heart to it yet. I said to myself, what about if a Muslim believes that Allah is personal, but he decided not to reveal himself, as I heard this from some back in Iran? To this, my response was clear. A just God does not hide himself against the injustice of Satan if he is the ultimate authority in justice. A personal God reveals himself in order to save and protect people from Satan. If Islam does not believe that salvation must take place in life on earth, then it is not a true religion. For Christ, a just, holy, and loving God must not ignore people's cry for salvation. Such indifference means cooperation with Satan. God must stand for justice. I tell you, this was a good-tasting revelation. The words of the gospel began to seem so real, true, delicious, and attractive to me. One by one, the beliefs to which I had been in bondage began to dissipate. I realized that an impersonal God does not exist, therefore the act of creation cannot be attributed to Him. He is a man-made God. The God of the universe must be personal and in touch with His creatures. I paused repeatedly as I pondered the wonder of such amazing revelations. Alone in my rented apartment, I was free to revel in my amazement, but still hesitant to share my convictions with anyone. The scriptures were powerfully eye-opening and functioned like a living teacher as I read. The first chapter of the Gospel of John was one of them. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through Him, and without Him nothing was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. We beheld His glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. John 1:1-4 and 14. I already knew that God or the ultimate reality in each religion was called the Word, but I did not know that the Word could reveal Himself in human flesh to demonstrate His heavenly glory and truth personally, setting a standard among humanity. I did not know that no human authority could establish the truth of God on earth better than God himself if they were not the supreme authority of the truth. Therefore, until the Word manifests and makes himself conceivable, no one will be able to reach freedom. He revealed himself in the flesh in order to prepare the way for the freedom of soul bearers. The revelation of God amazed me more than before as I read the following passages in the Gospel after understanding John chapter 1. This is my servant, whom I have chosen, the one I love and whom I delight. I will put my spirit on him, and he will proclaim justice to the nations. He will not quarrel or cry out. No one will hear his voice in the streets. A bruised reed he will not break, and a smoldering wick he will not snuff out, till he leads justice to victory. In his name the nations will put their hope. Matthew 12:18-21. The reason the Son of God appeared was to destroy the devil's work, 1 John 3:8b, and create peace among nations and between nations and God, Colossians 1:20. My aversion to the Christian's proclamation of Jesus as God was solved. I realized he was not a man-made God. Jesus was God, the Word and the Spirit, who revealed himself in the flesh in order to be accessible, known, and loved. God came to mankind in Jesus in order to redeem, sustain, and guide them till the end. In contrast, gods in other religions expect mankind to seek them. Neither is a personal man able to go to an impersonal God, nor is an impersonal God able to receive a personal man. In addition, man cannot unchain himself from the prison of Satan and go to God, since Satan is mightier than man and does not believe in his freedom. Everything was telling me that the true God is the God who comes and frees people from Satan. My misunderstanding about Jesus being the Son of God was fully removed as I read the Gospels. The accusation of the Quran is fully irrelevant. The Gospel never says that Jesus is the Son as a result of a sexual relationship between God and Mary. The sonship of Jesus is fully spiritual and describes his heavenly identity and citizenship. In the same way, the followers of Jesus are called the children of God. You are no longer foreigners and aliens, but fellow citizens with God's people and members of God's household, in which God lives by his Spirit. Ephesians 2:19-22. For you did not receive a spirit that makes you a slave again to fear, but you received the spirit of sonship, and by him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in his sufferings in order that we may also share in his glory. Romans 8:15-17. The identity of the followers of the heavenly Jesus is heavenly too. For this spiritual citizenship, they are called the children of God. While reading Apostle Paul's letters, Allah disappeared completely from my heart and was replaced by the holy God through Paul's amazing knowledge of God. Sin entered the world through one man, Romans 5:12. Through the disobedience of one man, the many were made sinners, verse 19. For since death is through man, the resurrection of the dead also is through a man. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all will be made alive, 1 Corinthians 15:21-22. Man, not God, is the creator of sin and the cause of humanity's downfall in the Bible. In Islam, Allah is the creator of sin and lawlessness. The Quran says that every misfortune and disaster on earth and in the human soul is ordained by Allah. Satan was corrupted by Allah. Sin was inspired by Allah and humankind. Allah created man in toil and trouble. Allah leads astray. I had never read and never wanted to read the Quran in Persian because it was taught that no one could understand the words of Allah, and therefore it would be better to recite it in Arabic. Also, Allah's preferred language was Arabic, and he only accepted the daily Islamic prayers in Arabic. We wanted to align ourselves with Allah's will and read the Quran in Arabic if we wished to receive his blessings. This caused us to miss many contradictions in the Quran, or we would have sometimes asked ourselves, why would a holy God create sin and corrupt people? Without knowing Allah, we called him just and holy. Can a just and holy God create sin? No. Isn't creating sin, sin itself? Yes. If Allah is the cause of every misfortune, disaster, and unrighteous act, what would you expect his followers to do? It is natural that they will follow the example of Allah. Doesn't the sin inspired by Allah affect Muslims' spiritual, social, moral, political, and economic life? It does. If Allah has inspired sin, then can the call of Allah upon his followers be practical and lead them to righteousness and peace with others? Not at all. I never knew that the God of the Bible was different to Allah. But now, after going to the church, I started to learn the difference that Satan was the creator of sin, not God. Adam and Eve followed Satan and brought sin into the life of humanity, not God. In the Bible, angels and mankind are created with free will. Satan, Adam, and Eve chose to abuse their free will and disobey God. Their rebelliousness is called sin. The God of the Bible is holy and just. Holiness cannot create sin. A just God cannot bear or tolerate sin or have fellowship with sin. I learned that a holy God inspires holiness in the heart of humans to have peace with him and one another. God used Paul, a former radical Jew who condemned and persecuted Christians, in the life of a Muslim, me, who was once radical and hated Christians and Jews. Paul's words made it clear to me that hatred between Muslims and Jews did not come from the holy God, rather from humanity. Unless we are saved and established in the purity of God, we will not be able to reconcile to one another. Hate what is evil, cling to what is good. Romans 12:9. Bless those who persecute you. Bless, do not curse. Verse 14. Or James says in his letter, the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. James 1:17. This was the lesson I learned in order to unclothe myself from the hatred of Islam and approach Jews with peace. I realized that the root of my hatred for Jews was because I was not united with the pure God and, therefore, was unable to imagine having peace with Jews. It was here that my heart sensed Jesus as the bearer of God's full glory and set a standard of love and care for people. Allah is not able to reconcile Muslims and Jews, but Christ can. If Allah is not able then, so are his followers unable. For decades, the world's superpowers tried to solve the conflict between Palestinians and Jews, but not only were they unable to reconcile the two sides, they fueled the hostility between them more and more. Why? First, the values of Christ have been missing there, and second, Islam was never understood clearly. The problem of the Middle East is at the root of Islam, that has sanctioned hatred for Jews. I learned from the gospel that if the root is holy, so are the branches. Romans 11:16. If God is holy, a peacemaker, righteous, loving, and joyful, so are his followers. The root of a belief lies in its God and central philosophies. We embody the characteristic of our root. The root supplies nutrition for the branches, and the branches are dependent on the root. The root of Islam is Allah. If Allah has inspired sin, which is stealing, lying, adultery, hatred, killing, and debauchery in his followers, then his call upon his followers cannot lead to peace and truth. Peace and truth cannot be from the creator of sin. For this reason, unless Muslims turn away from Allah, they will not be able to have a just and peaceful relationship with others. As a Muslim, I did not have the opportunity to investigate whether my root, Allah, was pure and true. Islam did not allow me to compare it with other religions. I, therefore, was ignorant and did not know whether my religion was logical or achievable. God brought me out from Iran so that I could discover Islam's impracticality and replace it with the truth. When I finished the New Testament, I read it again. I then read the Old Testament and other Christian books that were available. Reading Exodus 12:22 in the Old Testament, I was amazed, heartbroken, and then humbled as I remembered this exact religious practice in my hometown, Talesh. Some Muslim Taleshis, including my family, marked a cross on the top and both sides of the door frame with the blood of sacrificed animals or birds. Were these people Jews in the past, but kept it secret because of their fear of Muslims and then gradually lost their beliefs? This is possible because Jews lived in Iran since the time of Cyrus and Darius the Great. Islam asks Jews and Christians who live among Muslim communities not to manifest their religion publicly. It asks the males to clip the front of their heads as a shameful sign for being Jew or Christian. Some Taleshi Muslims practice clipping the front of their heads. Interestingly, some of them also had Jewish names that were not popular among Muslims. By this time, my belief in Islam was destroyed. I had valid reasons why God had to reveal himself through Christ and why revelation makes the God of the Bible superior to gods in other religions, including Allah. Now, I needed to gain a complete understanding for the superiority of Christ's social, political, and moral values, so I read the Gospels again, drawn to the root of Islam and Christianity. While I was amazed by the author of the Christian faith, I similarly was also amazed by his relational values for all foes and friends. Jesus says, "Love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you." Matthew 5:44. When I heard this for the first time in the church, I was not able to digest it. Islam had taught me that the enemy could not be loved. Islamic culture was alive in me, functioning in me as the root of disbelief. But now, I had to discover them one by one, get rid of them, and get myself established in the unconditional love of Christ. Nothing was more influential than His unconditional love to me. While I was His enemy, aiming to destroy His churches and replace them with mosques, He still loved me and gave His life for me. This was His approach to an enemy like me. His unconditional love was not a theory for me anymore. It worked on me so that I could approach my enemies with His logic, reason, love, and respect, and encourage them to share these beauties with me. It was so humbling to me that the God of the Bible did not rush into judgment to deal with me according to my hostile background. He rather invited me to reason with Him so I could discover the root of the problems in my life. In other words, His love and grace directed His justice to reveal Satan, the root problem in me, and with my consent destroy him rather than destroying myself. He had created me for Himself, and I was so precious to Him. From the depth of my heart, I sensed His true compassion and realized how He was different to Allah. It was here that I was convicted and decided to put the hatred of Islam behind me and throw myself into the ocean of Christ's love and to pray for my enemies. The words of the gospel opened my eyes to understand that in God's eyes there are no differences between me and my enemies. Both of us have broken the heart of God and are in need of His grace and love and forgiveness. In a similar way, I realized that men and women are the same in the eyes of God. They are created by the same God and have the capacity to search, understand, compare, and choose. Simply physical appearance cannot make one lesser or greater than the other. Man is not given more than woman or woman than man, especially when it comes to spirituality. God is spirit and relates Himself to humanity via their spiritual channel, the heart. In the spiritual arena, the heart is not defined by gender. Therefore, it is wrong, dehumanizing, and ungodly when Islam calls females deficient in their identity, understanding, or deeds. God created man and woman in order to describe unity and love strongly and supernaturally, not because one is better or has more than the other. The definition of a relationship between a husband and wife in the gospel was amazing to me. The gospel says that the unity and love between a husband and wife have to be similar to what is among the members of the body or flesh. They have to act sacrificial towards each other as Christ did to His church. To me, this was the most beautiful way of defining unity. It seemed very true to me. I was 33 years old when I read these passages in the gospel. I confirmed the truthfulness of this logic by using my own body as an example. In the entire 33 years of my life, I never realized for a single moment that my hands reject my feet or my eyes reject my ears. They loved each other and worked with each other harmoniously. In a body, if a member rejects the other, it means that this member's paralyzed and can no longer function in harmony with the others. The body with a paralyzed member is sick. With a similar logic, a family will not be healthy if the husband or wife does not have a unifying and loving faith. If the values of a society are not able to unite people together, that society cannot function as a cohesive and healthy society. More reading and meditation on the words of the Bible revealed to me the superiority of faith in Christ to all other beliefs and philosophies. I decided to put His life-giving words into practice and get myself released from any kind of self-centeredness or hostility. Number 1, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. Matthew 22:37. Number 2, love your neighbor as yourself. Matthew 22:39. Number 3, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Matthew 5:44. Number 4, love your wife just as Christ loved the church and gave Himself up for her. Ephesians 5:25. 5, there is neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. Galatians 3:28. Who has carried such qualities for life throughout history as Jesus has? Which religion or belief teaches such an unconditional love and includes all in its love, no matter of their gender, race, or ethnicity? The response was clear to me. Christ was the only one who brought down the walls of separation and united people with each other. He is truly the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings. The lords and kings of the world were not able to create such a peace among people, but Christ is able to bring people from all nations and races in order to make them the loving members of one body. He brought me out of darkness and hatred and established me in His peace. The only being hated in the kingdom of Christ is Satan, who separates people from one another. You cannot hate Satan unless you love God and humanity and desire to unite with them. There were times that I asked myself, why would a person like Jesus, with all these good qualities, be hated and crucified? The response that I found to this question in the Bible broke my heart and brought tears into my eyes. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and familiar with suffering. Like one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. He was assigned a grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, though he had done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. Isaiah 53:3-9. Why would men hide their faces from Jesus on the cross? Why would they reject him who loved unconditionally? Why would they kill him like a criminal when no crime was to be found against him? The gospel taught me that I did not need to go far. One of those men was in me. My own ignorance and fleshly desire, like a veil, were hiding my face from the truth. I myself was taught in Islam to rely on external things and therefore was unable to see the beauty of Christ's face. I dishonored and crucified him by putting him in an Islamic frame and rejected his gospel. We were never given an opportunity to read Islam's so-called rejected gospel and see how Christians viewed Christ and why. We disliked if anyone described him in a non-Islamic way. I had never known that Allah, Muhammad, all Muslim scholars, and myself had despised Jesus. All our religious emphasis in Islam was to believe ourselves better than others, to terrorize others, to seize their lands and properties and wives, and to extend the kingdom of Islam on earth. We called all these worldly works spiritual success and more worthy than the works of Christ. We were ignorant and did not know anything about spirituality and truth. We disrespected logic, reason, and confidence and approached non-Muslims with dishonor and hostility. We called our conditional love in Islam better than the unconditional love of Christ. Alas, I did not know that the supreme desire of Muhammad in Islam had nothing to do with forgiveness, righteousness, and spiritual progress, and therefore wasted half my life with the rituals and instructions of Islam. Islam focuses on the world and worldly desires. Jesus gave his life for friends and enemies to draw their attention to love and holiness, but Muhammad did not allow even his friends to express themselves in his presence. He slaughtered his opponents. How could I call Jesus less spiritual than Muhammad? How could Muhammad call himself, but not Jesus, the finisher of God's work? The prayer of Christ on the cross revealed all the misinformation and injustices of Islam and also the filth of my heart to me. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. Luke 23:34. No committed Muslim can fathom such forgiveness from Christ. That's why Muslim scholars and fighters have always tried to call Jesus a jihadist in order to justify their hatred of Jews and others. Time and time again, Yasser Arafat called Jesus the first Palestinian fedayeen, trying to relate him to Islam's sword philosophy against the Jews. As the veil of hostility had covered my face, it did the same with Arafat's, not allowing him to understand the heart of Christ. Our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the powers of this dark world and against the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly realms. Ephesians 6:12. Christ's war is not with humanity, but with the enemy of humanity, Satan. Satan cherishes ignorance, bigotry, hostility, and bloodshed. Christ humbled himself, left his heavenly glory, and appeared among us to save us, not to hate and kill us. His humble attitude shamed me for the hostility I had towards him and his people. I didn't know that the hostility in me was my own enemy too, but he knew. While I was not able to see this enemy in me, Jesus saw its ambush and became a shield for me against its arrows. Jesus had every right to ignore or reject me, but he didn't. His heart is like a faithful parent's heart that does not condemn his or her child for wrongdoings, but gives a chance and even lays down his or her life and wealth in order to protect the child against foes. This is what he did for me. Surely he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows. Yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by him, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. Isaiah 53:4-5. Every sacrifice of Christ turned my heart to my motherland, and I cried aloud to him and said, "You deserve to be the master of my nation. If you open their eyes, they will appreciate what you have done for them." I remembered a great proverb from my motherland that said, "Never forget even the kindness of an enemy." In my culture, unlike Islamic culture, if a person rescues you from death, you will always feel indebted to him or her, showing them a special respect. But if you turn your back on him, everyone will complain and say to you, "Is this your response to kindness?" Anytime you see this person, you have an obligation to remind him how he saved your life. You feel proud to call yourself a son, a daughter, a brother, or a sister to that person. After I realized what Jesus had done for me, I felt honored to call him my Savior, brother, father, redeemer, friend, or anything that could express my love and appreciation to him. For me, Jesus was no longer a son of jihad who imposes his beliefs on others. He was the son of kindness, love, holiness, justice, righteousness, wisdom, and reason. Through him, I learned the heart of God said that real victory in life was not in killing men and women, infidels in Islamic context, but sparing their lives for God. The desire for a person's death is a contribution to the kingdom of Satan because Satan loves death over life. Now, I needed to act against the desires of Satan and lead people to salvation and peace. I found it urgent to align myself with the mission of Christ to save souls, no matter who they were.